So, welcome everyone to the talk today from Christoph Möhl about YAPIC. I'm very happy to have you here today. This is a joint session, a collaboration between Open Wild Neuroscience and the Open Neuroscience. And I would like to first start by introducing Christoph. Christoph studied biology and computer science at Bonn University, and he graduated in 2005 with Professor Wolfgang Salz Group. He did his PhD from 2005 to 2009 at the Forschung Center Jülich and at Professor Merkel's group, where he applied quantitative fluorescence microscopy to investigate dynamics of cells. And then he did a postdoc at the lab of Darren Gilmore's group in Embl, Heidelberg, from 2010 to 2012. And from 2012 to 2020, he was the core facility leader of the image and data analysis facilities at the DZNE in Bonn, where he developed YAPIC together with the team. And he has left science this year, 2021, and he's working for IPS service near Bonn. And he's a data science and AI expert and developing software to predict sales of newspaper and print magazines. And I'm very happy to have you today here, Christoph, and to talk about YAPIC. And the stage is yours. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Miguel. Thank you also for this kind introduction and also giving me this room to show our YAPIC software. One moment, I just share my screen. So this tool that we are developing, the YAPIC tool, is short for yet another pixel classifier. And it's a Python library for image segmentation and deep learning. And it's not also a Python library, so you can also use it when you cannot code with Python. It's also a very easy to use tool that that can be used very easily. But now the question is, what does it exactly do? And therefore, we can, for example, look at this image here. It's an histology image of a brain slice. You see here a couple of cells in a bright field image. And these large cells you may see here, these are so-called Purkinje cells. These cells in the brain are located at the border of this dense region of the cells and this more sparse region of the cells. And when you do your research, you image data during your research, you are always interested to somehow quantify the information in your images. For example, we want to know how large these cells are, or we want to count these cells for a whole slide, or we want to know how sparse are they, what is their distance to each other. And for all these tasks to quantify the features of these objects, you first have to identify these objects, or to tell it, let's say, in a more image processing term, you have to first, so the first step is also to classify your image regions into regions that belongs to the cell objects and the regions that does not belong to the cell objects. And when you think, for example, so this can be a very easy task. For example, let's say you want to count cells in a cell culture dish, and you have a fluorescent stain of the nuclei, then it's very easy. You just set an intensity threshold to get the region where the cell are, and then you can count the cells in a second step. But if you look at this image, this is really hard because you cannot really apply an intensity threshold. These cells don't have a specific, a specific intensity according to their surroundings. To identify these image regions, you have to integrate a lot of different informations. For example, these cells have a certain location. They are always at this border of the tissue. They have a certain shape. They are a bit larger, but they don't really have a different, different intensities. So you have to integrate a lot of informations from a lot of different spatial scales. And this is exactly what YAPIC can do for you. So you can feed in this image into YAPIC, and you get an image where these cells appear as bright spots. And then it's easy to apply an intensity threshold and to go further with your image processing. So this also means you can never use this software as a standalone to do a full image analysis task, let's say, but you always use it as a part of your image analysis workflow. But it's a very important part, and often a very a part that is normally not so easy to achieve, especially if you have data like, for example, bright field images. But it also works, but we also apply it very often, for example, on fluorescent images. So with YAPIC, you can train your own image enhancement filter to enhance your structure of choice. So this means your structure of choice is enhanced, and all the rest is downgraded, so it's dark in the end. You can also train, so you can enhance more than one structures. Here, for example, we trained a model where we get these cells here in red, then we get these cells in the dense region, and then the cells in the dark region. And you can also apply this to very large images, here for example to a whole brain slice. Okay, so how do we do that? We use this so-called UNET, which is a so-called convolutional neural network, and this UNET was first described by Olaf Ronneberger et al. In 2015, and we started immediately in 2015 to develop this YAPIC tool because we saw that it's a great way to deal with this very important tasks that we had in our core in our image analysis group. I just want to explain it briefly how it works. So this UNET is, I like to call it a self-learning network of different image filters. So you have your raw image and you input it here, and then it is applied to 64 different processes, and the outputs of these processes are again feeded into 64 other ones, and then it's made a bit smaller, and then it's done again and again and again, so until it's very small, and then it's upgraded again, and finally as output you get these images with these so-called probability maps, where you only see your structure of choice. To assure that the network does the right thing, or to adapt the network to your specific structure of choice, you have to train it. And a training means you have to feed your images here. So you have to feed a set of training images here. And then you have to give the network how the output should look like. So you have to give the network also these images. And then the network can learn how to make these images by adjusting here all the numbers, all the weight within the network. So, and the YAPIC does this in a very easy and convenient way that you can train your network. This means that you can provide these output images, and how this works, I would like to show you. Okay, so we have also a UNet in 3D. So this means you can also apply 3D images or you can also analyze 3D images with this software. Okay, so how does this work that you can train such a model and then you have your own custom filter? It works like this, that you open a set of training images in your Elastic. So we use a software that is called Elastic to label the images, so to make the training data. So you open your image in this Elastic software, and this looks like this. So you have a set of images. Let's say you have 30 of these different images. So this is your training data set, and then you define five different regions. You define the different cell types, and then you just paint in the image where these cells are. And this is how the YAPIC can then learn what is the correct structure of choice. So just with this painting, let's say, so you generate these reference images that are used for the training to adapt the network, that you can then apply it to images that it has never seen before. I will show you how this works a little bit later in a live demo. So, so you do this, you don't have to draw the whole image, you just have to draw certain parts of the images, as I did it here. But you should not do it just with one image, but with a bunch of images. I think in this case, I labeled 30 to 40 images like that. Then I save a file with this software, with the Elastic. And this is this file here, this mylabels.ilp. This ILP file, I move to a server which has GPU, and the GPU is very important because this training process, so to train the network, this is very this uses a lot of computational time, and therefore you have to run it on a computer with a GPU, and that's why it's very convenient normally that you label your images on your own laptop, but then after you have labeled it, you move all the label data to a dedicated workstation or to a GPU cluster, for example, and then you can train the network with a command line interface, which I will show you later how this works. After the model is trained, you can apply it to other images to get the so-called, so to get the output, the so-called probability maps. Okay. I just want to show you that we recently developed another workflow together, so with support of this Chan Zuckerberg initiative. There, a plugin for the image analysis software Napari was developed by Nicolas and Pranjal. Here it works in a very similar way. So to you here, you label now your data within the Napari software with the YAPIC plugin. Now with the HDF5 labels plugin, then you train again with this YAPIC tool, and the model that you have trained, you can open again in the Napari and apply then the filter to your images in Napari. But this is still in development mode, so it works, but the older workflow, let's say this one, is a little bit more stable and more tested. So the command line interface is very easy to use. I don't want to get here into the details now, because I want to show it to you directly how it works. We also have a Python API, so you can also use it as a library, the YAPIC in your own code. But now I would like to show you how this YAPIC workflow works. So therefore, I just leave the presentation. I would like to show you the YAPIC homepage, where we have a tutorial. In the tutorial, there is a set of demo images and a demo Elastic project. And I have downloaded this this project. It's on my computer. It's a set of leaf images. One moment, I just open now the Elastic client software. Elastic can run on Mac and Windows and Linux. It's easy to install. And now I open this project. So here I have a project with different leaf images. Maybe I show you. One moment. Yeah, I have it. So here it looks in the folder structure. So I have my leaves example data. So with seven different leaves images, all look like this, TIFF images. And what I want to do, I want to train a classifier where I can detect these different leaf types. And this is also not, this is also already a tricky problem, because all these leaves have the same color, more or less, but they have different shapes. So you cannot use an intensity threshold for that. Okay, and now I imported three of these leaf images in the Elastic project and defined six classes to classify five different leaf types. I needed the sixth class, or here the first class, to label also the background, because you always need as many classes so that in the end you can classify each pixel of your image. So the yellow one is here now the background, and I already labeled a lot, but I can now also add more labels, for example here for the background. Or I add here some more label for this oak leaf type. The blue one, the maple leaf, and so on. And these other leaf types, I don't know the name. Okay, and you see that the other three images, I have also the same labels. And then I save this project, so this collection of images and labels, I save as a project file, and this is then this ILP file. Okay. So now I have my labels and I have my images. Now I can train the model. And therefore I use the YAPIC command line tool. Um, So you can install Yapik. Yapik is made with Python, so you can install it with this Python pip installer like this. If you want to try it directly now and you just do pip install Yapik, it will not work if you run exactly my toy example that you can download. I just found out yesterday when I prepared for this course that in the actual version, somehow the output of this leaf data set does not work correctly. So just in the future, you also just have to do pip install Yapik. But if you want to do it now, you have to do the following. You have to first install the Yapik. So you have to install slightly outdated versions. You have to install the Yapik IO 0.1.4. I think now it's here, it's installed for me. And you have to install the Yapik version 1.2.5. Okay. And then it will work. And I think in a few weeks, it will also work again with the actual Yapik version. Okay. So in this data directory, I have the, maybe I just go there. So in the data directory, I have this leaf example data where I have these TIFF files and I have the Elastic project. Now to run the Yapik, I just have to type Yapik, Yapik with H or with help. I can also show a help which kind of options I have. At the moment, I have a lot of options, but just to train it, I have to type Yapik train. Then I have to select the network that I want to use. I have at the moment two options. I have the UNet 2D and then I have a 3D UNet. Now I take the 2D UNet because we have 2D data. Then I define the folder where I have the TIFF images and I define the file with the label data. This is the Elastic project. And I guess this is all I need. I hope so. Let's see. So, and now the training is starting. So now I have an error. One moment. Maybe I set some paths wrongly. Yapik train unit 2D leaf example data. Maybe the problem was that I did not define the TIFF file specifically. No, so there is something. Not working. Very sorry for that. I just see if I may have some user error. So what I need is picture in it. Okay. Okay. So what you would normally see that we train a model and that we have then here this model file that is generated. And now this training, it normally takes some hours or some days on this GPU server. And after this time, you have the trained network here, and then you can apply it to your images. So let's hope that this works. Now I can apply this also with the command line tool. Now I don't say Yapik train, but I say Yapik predict. I define the model and I define the folder with the data. So I have to define the folder with the source data and of course the folder with the results data. Okay, and now so this is working. Now you see that these probability maps of the models are now written on my disk in the results folder. And now they will appear here one after another. Now when I maybe we can just have a short look to them. I open them in Fiji. So now I open one of the probability maps in ImageJ. And this is our predicted image. You see we have here now 5 color channels. Split the channel. So this is the background channel. This is the maple leaf channel, the oak leaf channel, and so on. And you see now it's not perfect. You have some artifacts. So we would need a little bit more labels to get a better prediction result. But now you can integrate these images in your image analysis pipeline, for example. When we would like to measure the area of these oak leaves, we can apply a threshold then do, for example, this analyze particles thing. And then we have found our objects. And these are now only the oak leaves objects, and this you cannot do directly from the raw data. So do this to discriminate between these different leaf types. Okay, then I think I will go on with the presentation because, I mean, this was a toy example, but what I would like to show you are some real life examples that we have done in our core facilities. So examples from our users. As I said, the training takes hours to days. So the running that did not work sadly in the live demo, but the prediction is very fast and the prediction you can also do on your laptop. That you have a good prediction result, you need a quite large amount of training data, but not too large. So the training data includes normally, let's say, 10 to 40 images. It's very dependent on the problem that you want to solve. And our labeling is usually very sparse. So we use a lot of images, but not so many labels for image. And normally from my, so what I have seen when I worked with the people, that normally the labeling is done by one person in two iterations. So that the person, let's say, she needs 3 to 4 hours to for the initial labeling. Then we run the training with the RPIC train. We look at the results. And then we see, okay, here we need some more labels, there we need some more. And then we have a second iteration where we add some more labels. This takes 1 to 2 hours. And then we train again. And then normally we have a working classifier. So here you see some example. This is new write detection in a label-free assay. So these from Max Schelsky, Brad Group at the DTNA in Bonn. You see here these images that look like a fluorescent label. It's actually not. This is the output of the YAPIC. So this is an assay completely label-free, just phase contrast or bright field, I don't know. Because these cells are very sensitive to fluorescent light. And therefore, Max just used a bright field imaging and then trained a classifier to get specifically the dendrites and the cell Zoma. And then he put these images into a pipeline to then detect the neurites and to measure the growth over time, so to quantify neurite outgrowth. This is an histology example again from Anja Meyer Behorn. She had to quantify or to count cells with this DAB stain that are positively and negatively labeled and count these different cells. And these DAB stains are very tricky to quantify because you have a lot of background and so on. And therefore, she also trained a YAPIC classifier, three different classes, background in yellow. You see here a label image of hers. So background in yellow, then green are the positive cells and red are the negative cells. And then you see here now the overlay of the YAPIC output. With the negative cells here and the positive cells here. And then this was feeded I don't have to go here into the details. We imported then the output, so the positive and negative object into the QPath, where then the cells were finally counted in interactive regions that were selected by the user. Here another example, so 3D fluorescence time series, where cell tracking was applied. And if you do 3D fluorescence time series, you also always have the problem with a lot of noise. And when you have a lot of noise, you cannot discriminate here the different cells from each other. Therefore, also a classifier was trained to get a little bit, so a denoising and a better discrimination of the cells. So this is the raw data. Here you see the raw data. Then in red, you see the YAPIC output. And we feed it then the YAPIC output into IMARES, and in IMARES we run then the 3D spot detection. And you see here these points are the points then that are detected by IMARES. Okay, another example, actin filament detection in electron microscopy slides. With electron microscopy, even if we have such nice data as here, so you see here actin structures, But you always have a lot of artifacts like these membrane structures here, and you want to get rid of these membrane structures. And so we trained a classifier just to get the actin structures and everything else, all the rest in the background class. And the YAPIC filtered output was then later fed into an object detection tool, I think, to measure the lengths of these actin filaments. Yeah, and here you see now the YAPIC output in red, which is, yeah, let's say a clean actin network now without all these membrane rests and preparation artifacts. Okay, so to summarize, YAPIC is a very user-friendly command line tool for pixel classification based on deep learning. The training data collection is quite easy when you use, for example, the Elastic labeling interface, or in the future, you can also use the Napari interface. We keep it easy to install, and yeah, you can operate it via command line or integrate into your Python code. Finally, I would like to thank a couple of people. So I want to thank Manuel Schölling. I started developing with him YAPIC back in 2015 when he worked at the core facility as D3NE in my group. Pranjal Dole and Nicolas have developed or are actively developing this this Napari plugin for YAPIC. Yeah, and I also want to thank Miguel, who is not only chairing this talk, but he's also now the leader of the Emission Data Analysis Group and also coordinating now the YAPIC development. And I also want like to thank the leader of all the core groups at the DZNE, Eugenio, who always was very, very supportive, let's say, from the beginning on, that we were able to develop this tool. And also when we want to make it open source, he also helped there a lot. So thank you very much. Also want to thank all our testers that make this tool really work. And I would like to thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Christoph, for this nice presentation and for showing us YAPIC. YAPIC is a great example of open source tool that can be used by biomedical students, researchers, or any person that wants to apply deep learning to this challenging images. I would like to give the chance first to the people that join us in the meeting, if they have any questions. Please feel free, you can unmute yourself and ask the questions directly to the speaker, or you can write and then I can read the question. And Jordana Jonsson says, thank you for the thorough presentation, for the nice presentation, but maybe if you have questions, feel free to step in. Are there any questions from the people that join us? So while I wait, the people maybe ask additional questions or any question, I will start. I was wondering, Christoph, where do you see the next development for YAPIC to make it even more user-friendly and easy to use for people that are afraid of a command line, for example, and want to just easily do it? Where would you see YAPIC, let's say, the next developments? What would you do?
Yeah, so I think it's very important that it's really user-friendly. The command line interface is nice because it's very lightweight, let's say, and you can also run it on a server and so on. But of course, you also then lose a lot of users. I think the answer is not just to make a GUI for the command line interface, because you really have to, so because it really makes sense to run this on a central server, no? On a GPU cluster. And therefore, what I mean, what I would really like, that we would that we would have some job scheduler and a web interface so that the people go to the web interface, they can upload their labels and just hit train, and then they get a mail when the train is done, and then they just download their file, and then they can apply this file, for example, in ImageJ with the Deep ImageJ plugin, or they can apply then this file in a Cell Profiler, or also in the Yapik Napari plugin, for example. So this would be, I think, the most user-friendly way. Yeah.
Okay. Any question from the people that join us? We have some people that join us also. Okay. If not, I will follow up. I have a follow-up question. So from your own experience, you have used a lot Yapik, and so you have experience with different kind of images, different kinds of challenges. What is the challenging part for then segmenting these images and that Yapik is helping? What do you think you have to pay attention when you're using Yapik? Which kind of labels are important, like when you are drawing them and so on? So it's easy for the people that want to use it.
Yeah, so the problem is, or the challenging part is, that you always, if you label your data, you do it, let's say, in a blind way, because you label it and you don't know, are this label really useful? You only see it one day afterwards when you have trained the network, and then you see the result. And this is, let's say, this means you need some experience with labeling. So you have to gain this experience over time. For example, one hint is, as I already told you in the talk, that you should label rather more images and not each image completely. Another point is that you should label, let's say, border regions, so that you maybe I can share my screen again and just show these labels of the...
Yeah, please.
So if you look here, for example, at my labels, no, of this leaf, I labeled a lot of borders. No? I labeled here the inside and the outside border of the leaf, and these borders are really... are really needed. And let's say, from my experience, the most valuable label regions for the classifier are where I have a lot of different classes in the same region, so where I have a lot of borders. Yeah, this is one hint that I can give.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so I don't see any questions also on YouTube or here in the talk. I would close the session then, but the people that join us can stay on and can then interact, or if additional people join, I can also interact with Christoph directly and ask questions, and we're going to have a more informal discussion. I'd like to thank you once more, Christoph, for the presentation, for taking the time to show us Yapik. Also, the links are, you can see the links to the project and to the website in YouTube and recording. And next week, you can join us next Friday, where we'll have David Tatris and Mathieu Louis talking about Pi VR, so an affordable and versatile closed-loop platform to study unrestrained sensory motor behavior. And the link will also be part of YouTube. And you can see the talks at the open source neuro platform on the worldwide website. So thank you once more, and we hope to see you next week and in the following talks. Thank you
very much.